Hey guys, I hope you're hungry. Welcome back to War Stories here on the Fluencer channel. My name is Jericho, and today I am joined by the whole gang. We got HolyDiver, CyannSentry, and TheIceMann.
Hi.
Hello.
Hello.
I'm the guy in the bottom. I'm HolyDiver.
Yes, everybody's actually here in person for once, which is a neat time. So HolyDiver and I are playing survival together just for fun. Like you said, he's on the bottom and I'm on the top.
Yeah.
And we all just saw Logan last night, and we are going to talk about it today. So as usual, we'll start with our random first impressions, then we'll go into what we thought about the movie, and then we'll finish up in the last few minutes with some spoilery talk. But I think we can keep it mostly non-spoiler, especially since I think we all agree that the movie's predictable, if not inevitable. So I don't think spoilers are as big a concern with it anyway. So anyway, who would like to get us started with their impressions?
I'm sad.
Okay. Speak to that.
It was really, really, really good. It was very well done. It hurts. Like, just it, for all the right reasons, of course. It's taking place pretty farther in the future than anything else we've seen in the X-Men universe.
Yes, this is set in 2029, whereas the originals were in the 2000s, and the most recent like Apocalypse is like in the early 80s, I think. So a good bit before anything else.
And this is in the trailer, so I don't think it's a spoiler, but almost all the mutants are gone at this point.
Mm-hmm.
And Logan's old, Xavier's old, and it's just, it's incredibly depressing. But again, for the right reasons. Like, I literally felt, like, I told the guys when we got back that I felt like we had just been to a funeral.
Yeah.
How about you, HolyDiver?
I felt that it was exploitative and, like you said, very predictable. I thought that it was a very, very good movie. It was a very, very good movie. The acting was phenomenal. The direction was It felt to me like they wanted to make a rated R superhero movie, but not a fun, funny one like Deadpool. Yeah, not a fun, funny one like Deadpool. This is one where you're gonna have all the cursing and all the blood, and everybody you love is now in pain and sad and. I understand that they're trying to go for a more realistic, gritty thing, but they just took it too far. And it felt very disconnected from the other X-Men movies. Like, they went so far into believability that it was unbelievable, because it just, that stuff just didn't make sense in the context of the world that they had created. And it wasn't just that the story and continuity is wrong. I mean, every X-Men has just made up their own continuity for the most part, but...
Can I react to that?
Please do.
Yeah, and I want you as well, and then we'll get to Chris's reactions. Iceman, I should say.
Well, I kind of feel like I don't know if it's fair, but I felt like this was the more real view, and the previous X-Men movies was like how Logan in the movie he was talking about the really dressed up versions of the comic books and all that, which was a really cool part of the movie. And how they made everything seem way more fantastic than it was, and it only a quarter of the stuff happened and it didn't really happen that way, that kind of thing. So I kind of feel like the movies that we've seen before were more like that. Like they were, you know, through this filter that was okay for kids. And now we finally got to see what really was happening.
That's exactly what I said on the car ride home with the two of them. That
really?
The older movies were our propaganda.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, that's the nice movie to show that, oh, it's not so bad. You don't have to feel bad for the mutants. It's not like we're going to put a nice picture on it. But in actuality, this is how it is.
Yeah.
But I only agree with it up to a point. Like, I don't know why Professor X needed to curse all the time. I thought that didn't match what we know about his character. Like, just because he's old and infirm, like, he no longer cares about...
He's senile. A lot of older people that have been proper and prim their entire life suddenly get vulgar when their mind starts to go.
I guess so, but it was, like, in some of his, like, most lucid times that he was doing that.
Yeah. Well, maybe Logan rubbed off on him.
Yeah, that's true, too. That's been his only company.
Mm-hmm.
So, what did you think, Iceman?
Yeah, and just to that, with the, Xavier, I just kind of had a thought about him cursing, because I definitely felt the same way, too. Like, probably unnecessary. But, if Logan was really the real version of what's happening, maybe Xavier was always like that.
Mm-hmm.
And this is just, we're seeing the real him for the first time.
Yeah, and we did see that he was more careful when the girl was around.
Mm-hmm.
So he was always around kids before.
Right.
Yeah. And we learned, I mean, what we've learned about what he was when he was younger with the James McAvoy movies, I would believe that he would grow up cursing and hating life and hating weakness. And, I mean, they've never made any bones about that. That's the same person. That's just what he's going to grow up to be. So it's pretty...
And see, I agree with all that. And that all, like, it makes sense that that's what they're going for. And I understand. I just disagree with it. Because I think it just disrespects what all the other movies were trying to do. And, like, if you just say that they're all propaganda, it's like, oh, well, okay.
Well, but that's just in the movie of this universe. It doesn't invalidate the other movies are. Like, just because you don't like... Like, Star Wars Episode 1 doesn't mean anything happened to the original trilogy.
It's a fine line. I can really see both sides. So say this is the real version of the other one, the propaganda. It's still the same. It's like, still the same actors, so it's like...
Right.
It's not like this is a different Wolverine and a different Xavier, you know? Like, that's who they were before. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
we were just seeing them through a gloss before.
Mm-hmm.
But in general, I tend to agree with CyannSentry. Just so good, but so sad. The first thing I said to everybody after we got out of the theater was that was amazing, but I don't ever want to see it again.
Yeah.
It's very heavy. A lot of people are saying it's like The Dark Knight, and I guess they mean that in terms of like. What it says about the character, just how good the filmmaking was and all that sort of thing. But as far as the content, as the feel of it as a movie, I thought it had a lot more in common with Dark Knight Rises because it had the same feeling of inevitability. Inevitability and death and pain. And I kind of like went on and on in the car. To me, this is an important movie, and it's a movie that I really have a lot of respect for. Because, like, what made the Dark Knight trilogy so great is Christopher Nolan wanted to say something about, police states and watching people when he did the cell phone thing in Dark Knight. And he wanted to say something about, like, the 1% in Wall Street and all that stuff in Dark Knight Rises. And he said, I'm going to make a movie about Batman, but I'm going to say what I want to say about the real world through it because I'm not going to be restricted by the fact that it's a comic book to not make the mature, important movie that I want to make.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what they did with Logan. And I said in the car, like, I want that for every superhero, for them to take the lens of a beloved character, especially one, like, if not for the other movies, we would not care of his fate so much. Like, if this was just, like, a lot of people compared it to The Last of Us. If it was a Last of Us movie, like, it was just telling that story, like, we would have to learn to care about this character. But we've seen him. Have fun and calling people bub. He didn't say call anybody bub in the entire movie, you know? Like, that part of him is gone, and it's just...
That's just propaganda. It's not actually real.
I'm talking about from the point of view of the audience, obviously.
Well, no, I
understand.
The audience
knew and saw that character.
Yeah. Yeah, I definitely feel like we lost a couple of really good friends from this. And I don't know how to feel about it, because it was just, it was incredibly well done, and it was exactly what it was supposed to do. But I definitely agree that comic book movies should be able to say what they want to say using characters. Like, that's, to me, that's like a major point of comic book characters in the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
Like, X-Men has always been about judging people by the way they look, or race,
rights and integration. Yeah. And
yeah, and every comic book series seems to have their, like, their thing, you know, the thing that they're fighting for or against. Like, of course, the obvious one is Captain America, Superman, things like that, that are fighting for truth or justice or whatever. But then you have much more real world things like the X-Men. I think that's why it spoke to so many people. Is that it hit home for a lot of people.
Mm-hmm. I agree with that for sure. But it's definitely not a fun movie. Well, I would say even more than Deadpool, don't go in expecting a comic book movie like any other you've seen. And I think, I guess to get into spoilers a little bit, like, Batman vs. Superman, you know, the finale of that movie had something to say about the death of a beloved character. And I would challenge them to look at this movie and see how much more effective they were able to make him do it, because it was earned with what they've done with this character.
Absolutely.
Oh, yeah.
Not just in the other movies, but throughout this movie.
It didn't feel like just a stunt.
Right. And, like, there was no... Everything about it was final. But I thought it was very beautifully shot. I was mentioning one thing that I thought was really cool at the beginning of the movie. Every time they showed Logan in an establishing shot, they would show him... from the chest up and very close to frame, like making him the dominant part of the frame of the picture. But as the movie progressed, he would be further and further away, show like his diminishing strength and like,
I didn't notice that. Really
his presence
cool.
on the world is diminishing. Well, that's like the coolest part is like you didn't notice it, but your brain did.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah. It's awesome.
And the music was really good. I really liked the settings. Iceman mentioned that it was almost like a post-apocalyptic movie at first.
Mm-hmm.
Like, because it is so, you better just use a, well, I don't know, let's see.
You got this.
It's so miserable in a good way. Well, but also in a bad way. Like, I'm going to get the movie because I want to see it again, and I want to see what I missed. You know, watch it with captions because, like, some of the lines are a little bit garbled.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But this is not a movie like to just flip on while you're doing something else, or to watch, you know, for fun. And if you think that movies are made only for fun, I don't know if I would give it a recommendation. But if you like a movie that's willing to say something, and like in basically every sense of the word, willing to go there, I think that this was really something special.
Yeah.
But it was not without its flaws. One scene that I thought was really weird. So Logan is employed as like a basically an Uber driver in the movie. So there's like a montage of him giving a bunch of people rides, and it doesn't really. I guess it's just showing like the monotony of his life, or like this is all he feels he can do, or whatever. But like there's this a girl in his limo that like flashes him, and I guess it's like, well, we're just gonna do it. But it didn't tell us anything about her character. It didn't tell us anything about Logan's character. It definitely felt like, what the hell? Let's just do it.
Yeah.
And I don't know why. Maybe one of you guys picked up on something I didn't. But that, I thought, was... That was, to me, like, one of the more exploitative, or just like, we just want to do this. So I don't know how I felt about that. Well, I do know how I felt. I didn't really like it very much, but...
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. Sorry, did you have any revelations on that score?
I felt like they were just trying to show Logan just kind of done with life. You know, he didn't show any interest. He just kind of shook his head, you know. And I don't know what else he would do in that situation, but...
Yeah.
I don't know. I guess that was just supposed to be well, he's not the virile Wolverine that we're used to.
Yeah. I thought, like, it was like a bachelorette party or whatever, like, they were all getting out of the car. I thought one of them would, like, try to throw themselves at him, and he would be like, come on, you're just a kid, or, like, show, make it more obvious that they're trying to say he still has it in him to be protective and to care and to not. And like you were saying, like, there was a time when Wolverine would have been like, neat. Well, what a day for a wolf.
Yeah.
But, but I don't know, like, I guess they either should have done more or less with it.
Yeah.
Another thing, and I'll pass it around to, like, everybody else's, you know, little grants or whatever. It's really tough to see Professor X as a feeble, senile old man. And it's really sad, you know, and as someone who had, you know, infirm grandparents, it's very hard to watch. And I know HolyDiver disagrees. I don't think it was exploitative because, again, that's what happens to people. Like, to pretend it's not is the propaganda we saw in the other movies, where being in a wheelchair your entire life and being an old man is whatever, it's fine. But it got really, really tough to watch. So, I don't know. And I don't know, like, I don't know if maybe that was essential. Like, I don't know what the movie would have felt like if not for that sort of energy surrounding the character of Charles. But I don't know. So we'll start with Iceman this time. Like, what were some things that you didn't like as much?
Oh, whoops.
Oh.
Before the subject gets too far away from us, I do want to talk about what you just talked about, Xavier's civility.
Uh-huh.
That was pretty well done, and it is uncomfortable, and it is a horrible, sad thing to see. That's what happened to my grandfather before he passed. That's kind of how he was, and it was uncomfortable and not fun to watch, but it needed to be.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, and that's why I say, like, it still didn't feel like exploitation, just because of how well done it was, right. And like, it's not, they didn't show him like unable to control his bowels or like you know, like, they could have made it like just really, just like brought it to a really dark, disgusting place, and they got right up to it, but I think they did show a little bit of restraint, and that's what kind of saved it for me.
But we talked about this last night. One of my biggest gripes with the movie was the main villain, Donald, whatever his name was, the guy with the robot hand.
Aww.
Still don't know who he is or why he's so upset.
He's so mad.
Yeah.
You know, like, he has no arc.
We have no idea what his motives are.
Yeah, nothing at all. And 2/3 of the way through the movie, like we also said, they introduced another villain, the Doctor.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, who was made more important and did make his motivations known, and like, why he was important to the story, why he mattered both to this movie and to the wider universe.
But he came out of nowhere.
Yeah, it's like, hey. And like, literally, it was well past the halfway point that they decided that this guy was important.
It's easy to say, well, this is what I would have done after seeing it, but establish the Doctor early and then just have Donald be his higher gun.
Yeah, all we needed is one little scene, a few seconds. Like a Emperor Vader kind of talk.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I definitely agree that was not the best villain in the world. And speaking to the villains, they had, I guess this is semi-spoiler, they had a, they call him X-24.
Yep.
Yeah, so the little girl you see in the trailers is X-23, and that's what she's called in the comics, and it's basically, they refer to her exclusively as Wolverine's daughter, and it is, I guess, from his blood cells, but I think usually in the comics she's more a clone, but a younger female clone. And before we move on from her actress was amazing.
Mm.
Super, super good, especially for a kid.
Incredible.
Like, in a movie where every single actor did a good job, not even the background people. We're all.
She didn't even talk for most of the movie.
Yeah.
She was awesome.
Oh, yeah.
Very impressed.
Like, she managed to stand out in a scene with Patrick Stewart, you know?
Yeah.
Like, when she wasn't even saying anything.
Uh huh.
Mm hmm.
But anyway, so she used X-23. X-24 is the character that CyannSentry is going to talk about, which was, you know, as the name would suggest, the next evolution or whatever.
Yeah. So I don't know if he's a direct clone of Wolverine or just his son that looks just like him or what, but he looks exactly like a younger Wolverine, but he's, you know, bad guy. I don't know. It was really, really on the nose for me. Like I was saying yesterday, that
just to end.
He's like Wolverine's his own worst enemy. You know, that's just
There's no subtlety.
Yeah, no subtlety at all. It could have just not been done. I would have been happy with that not being a part of it.
I agree with that. I mean, it was sort of cool, I guess, but we've seen him fight other people with claws a million times, mm-hmm. so.
But that was one cool thing about this movie, though, so with it being rated R. In the past, we've seen Wolverine, you know, he'll slash down a few enemies, but they always just, you know, they fall off screen, we don't see any blood. It felt very safe. And this one was not like that. This is much more, you know, Wolverine fans that want to see him just mow down entire groups of people hacking and slashing through the whole thing with his claws. Just, you get that in this movie. So I know I've heard people before complain about that.
Yeah, when Wolverine slashes you, like, your chest is gone. Yeah. You don't just, like, fall with nothing visible on you.
Right.
Yeah, so if that's what you've been waiting for in a Wolverine movie, you definitely get more than enough of that.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so...
One other thing is kind of speaking to your thing, Jericho, about Professor X's age and all that, and one thing I thought was really a stroke of brilliance was his seizures.
Mm-hmm. That was really cool.
Xavier has these seizures in the movie, and I don't know exactly the physics of it, but it basically makes everybody freeze in place. They can't breathe. They can't move. And it seems to be causing a great deal of pain.
Mm-hmm.
And that makes total sense for Xavier. Like, for those of you who don't know, a seizure is basically an electrical storm in the brain. Like, the synapses just fire randomly. There's no control.
And that's why you have the jerky body movement. It's because the parts that control those muscles are
deciding
to go randomly.
Yeah, they get triggered. Everything's like overheating. It makes sense that in a brain that has the kind of mind powers that Xavier does, that it would cause major issues like that.
Mm-hmm.
So I thought that was really brilliant.
And the movie heavily hints that he had previously had what happened before that ended in disaster and killed a lot of people, and that's why he's basically in hiding with Logan at the outset of this movie. So, HolyDiver, do you have anything you would want to point out?
Not really. I think you guys have summed it up much. I don't know. I don't like it as much as you guys do, because I feel that... I feel like they either should have done more to establish that this is a different universe, or something, because it just doesn't make sense with all the other X-Men movies. And, like, I understand continuity is always weird, but either Logan is a completely different universe and you shouldn't care about it, or all the other movies don't really matter because it's going to end in Logan. And it's like, why... That makes it hard to swallow.
Well, I definitely don't agree with that. Like, why, even if they are different universes, why should we not care? Like, if they're not perfectly possible within that timeline, So what? It's a good movie.
I mean, it is. It just...
And like, yeah, it'll end with Logan, but everybody in every movie is gonna die.
Yeah, that's literally the point of this movie. Everyone dies. I mean, everyone has to face the reality in the end.
Yeah, and I see that was the point. I think they just should have showed a bit more restraint and not gone as far in the directions that they went.
One more thing before we kind of give our closing thoughts or whatever. We mentioned that it was not so subtle to have him fighting a younger version of himself, like literally battling his own demons or whatever. But some other things that they did were really cool because it did show subtlety and restraint. I guess it's just one specific scene I wanted to talk about that I thought was cool. They did a lot of setups and payoffs. Like, at the beginning of the movie, Wolverine and Professor X are being assisted by a mutant called Caliban. And Caliban tells Wolverine, you can't even read the prescription on that pill bottle. And then later, Professor X says, I know you can't see. And then later, we see Wolverine wearing reading glasses, but he hasn't even taken the label off because, like, I don't need these. This is stupid. I'm going to just return them. And then later, we see him wearing them again with the label off. So, like, four times we revisit it, and the characters don't really say anything about it besides at the beginning saying, like, that you can't see. But Logan never says a word about it, but... He accepts that he has to have glasses to see now, and that's accepting that he is weak and old. You know, that's a significant thing for Logan, and they do it very subtly, almost, you know, wordlessly. I thought that was just a cool little touch.
Yeah.
Okay, so we've been going for quite a while. I guess we'll be wrapping up here. But does anybody have any other thoughts? Anything else they wanted to mention?
Just to reiterate that X-23, I can't remember the name that they gave her. Laura,
yeah.
She was really incredible. She did a great job.
Mm-hmm.
And I would like to see more of her.
Yeah, absolutely.
Sure. Yeah, definitely. Yeah, I don't know. I'll never, you know, watch it casually, like we said, but I thought it was incredibly well done. And just, I don't know, kudos to them for, you know, saying what they wanted to say about this character. I felt like it definitely was on the edge, and maybe even straying over it in some ways, but I appreciated what they wanted to do with the movie.
Yeah, I'm glad they didn't just play it safe.
Anybody else have anything else?
I agree with everybody.
Oh my god. That's impossible! Alright, well, thank you everybody for watching. I hope you enjoyed. I guess, if I could... I don't know if I speak for everybody, but... If you go into it expecting that you might like it, but you might not like yourself because of it... I would definitely recommend to see it.
Yeah.
Don't expect a fun night at the movies. But expect a hell of a movie.
Yeah, no, this
very,
is
very well made.
This is the superhero version of Passion of the Christ and Schindler's List and Downfall and stuff like that.
You know, yes, I almost made the comparison to Passion of the Christ because obviously the subject matter in Passion is much different.
Yeah.
And probably more.
I mean,
important.
A little different.
But but the feeling I got after watching Passion is the same feeling that I have now. I have not seen the Passion since it first came out. I watched it one time.
Yeah, and I watched it in theaters and never again. Which I probably will watch Logan again, but
yeah, that's heavy. That's a good point. Yeah, very heavy. But I think if you go in expecting that, I think you'll really enjoy it because it's also some incredible filmmaking.
Oh yeah.
So thank you everybody for watching. Thank you to all the gang for joining me. We're hoping to have some more war stories featuring these guests while they're in town. So make sure you subscribe to the Full Incense YouTube channel so you don't miss any of that. Special thanks to HolyDiver for joining me in the gameplay today.
Hooray.
And we will see you guys next time. How about you guys? But we are all full.